If you could please take your seats, the meeting will start in 15 seconds.
One, two, three. Yeah. Okay, we're mic'd up. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, county assessors from across the great state of California, distinguished guests and visitors. Welcome to the annual board meeting with the county assessors on the occasion of the 109th County Assessors Association annual conference. We want to extend our appreciation to the Speaker Pro Tem, John Perez, and Senate Pro Tem, Mr. Steinberg, for providing us this room today and to have this historical meeting in a number of ways. In the 1800s, the county assessors were summoned to Sacramento to meet with the board members at the state capitol. We are back here again today. Things have changed drastically over the years. As we all know, these are very challenging times. So it's extremely important that we have this opportunity to get together to seek out ways to improve the economy here in the state of California and opportunities for the citizens in which we represent. Despite these challenging times, things have gotten better. Here in California, we have experienced an increase in property taxes to the tune of $5.3 billion, which represents approximately 1%, which is indicative of the fact that California is moving in the right direction. But it will take the ingenuity, the creativity, the imagination of the individuals in this room to reach out beyond the cutting edge to find solutions to improve our efficiency and effectiveness to collectively and individually in the positions that we represent. So on behalf of my colleagues at the Board of Equalization, I would like to welcome you to Sacramento for this year's meeting and thank you for taking the time away from your annual conference to meet with the board members. We will start with each of our members. The board members will make a quick introduction as well, and then we will go to the distinguished individuals who now represent the county assessor, first starting with the former president, Mr. Doug Wacker from Lake County, and the current president-elect, Tom Bordonero from San Luis Obispo, who will extend their words of welcome after the board members. But let me start out by I'm off script. In fact, I skipped a lot of it just to save us a little time. Let me start out by thanking my colleague, Ms. Betty Yee, for initiating and the reuniting of the county assessors and the Board of Equalization. A number of years ago, she reached out to the assessors, and she began to bring us together in a collaborative way to work together to find solutions that will benefit the state of California. So I want to thank her, but I want to first say to her, happy birthday.
Oh, God. Uh-huh.
Normally I would sing a little song, but we don't have that much time, fortunately for you. So we'll start with the birthday lady, Ms. Betty Yee.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Good morning, and thank you for the birthday wishes. I want to first thank Mr. Chairman for convening us all in this wonderful hearing room. Everyone's comfortable. We hope to have a good panel discussion on two very important issues facing the state and the counties this morning. I wanted to first start by thanking the leadership of the California Assessor Association. Every year when we summon you to meet with the board, I always appreciate the cooperation in terms of the agenda setting, but more importantly, just throughout the year, the ongoing engagement that we've been able to have on very critical issues that I think really speak to the good partnership that we have, the board has with the county assessors in the administration of the property tax system in California. I want to acknowledge some of the challenges that all of you have been facing, and I think it bears some some mention, just because these are some very, very trying times, not only just for the state, but we know county resources are also very, very constrained, and you've had some workload increases in the recent past, certainly with the activity in the housing market, with the foreclosure crisis here in California, and being very, very responsive to homeowners and property owners throughout the state. Not only with your proactivism in terms of looking at where it's appropriate to take values down, but certainly now working through the Prop 8 petitions that are before you. And I want to just applaud you for your continued diligence in addressing that workload. We have lots of challenges facing us ahead, and I wanted to just identify some of them, and some of the ones that I particularly will be focused on in the year with many of you, and particularly those assessors in my district who have continued to be very forthright in identifying issues of statewide concern as they arise in their particular county. First, we know that California is going to be a leader in the alternative green tech economy and the development of that economic sector. And as we look at alternative energy facilities, it poses, I think, some new challenges and new ways of thinking relative to how we value those properties. We have existing property tax exclusions. We have other tax incentives that are outside of the property tax realm that affect these alternative energy initiatives, but also say that I think as we go forward, we're going to be challenged with also looking at some valuation issues relative to these facilities, and I hope that we can have a proactive dialogue about this, so to really get out ahead of the issue and engage the industry a bit as well as far as being of one mind as to how we look at these issues of valuation and also the application of the various tax exclusions. Secondly, I know that in many of the counties we have the prominence, and I think this is a great sign for our economy, but certainly the prominence of the economic sector that is where there are many contributions being made by our tribal communities. And whether it be casinos or other business enterprises, there will be issues that will involve tribal communities, particularly around issues of possessory interests and the like. And I would like to let you know that I am committed as chair of the Business Taxes Committee for the board to establish, hopefully before the end of the calendar year, a tribal advisory council that will be solely focused really on a government-to-government level, looking at these issues and being able to have a dialogue very openly about understanding what the practices have been, what limitations there might be with respect to how we apply traditional property tax law on tribal communities. And then thirdly, I do want to acknowledge the great workload increases that have been experienced by counties, and I, as an individual member of this board, continue to be an advocate for providing state resources to shore up the property tax administration system and all the work that you do. We've had state assistance in the past through a loan program, through a grant program, and we know that for a very modest amount of investment by the state, we can really see some great returns with respect to additional property tax revenue that certainly can help our state's fiscal situation relative to our general fund as aid for schools. So I hope that we can engage the legislature going forward on reenacting a similar program that really, I think, does have great bang for the buck on a fairly modest investment. And then lastly, let me just say this. With all of these challenges, what I've been heartened by is really the new models of working that we've been able to engage with the assessor community, but more importantly, with the assessor community and the business community. As we look at new businesses, new economic sectors, new technologies emerging, and certainly old technologies that are being modernized, and we'll speak to some of that this morning relative to the embedded software issue, I really appreciate the engagement of both the assessor community and the business community in terms of information sharing. This is critical to the work that we do, and certainly I think a critical element in terms of being very, very clear about what the rules are going to be going forward, and really having the best information possible from the business community, and albeit sometimes very proprietary information that will be treated with the utmost sensitivity and confidentiality by this board and our staff. So it's been a model that's worked with respect to the valuation studies that we've had completed in the recent past, and I believe it's a model that will continue to work if we all are committed to coming together and sharing information and really looking to an outcome that will provide clarity and also processes that will be easy to follow. So, Mr. Chairman, I, with that, I look forward to the discussion this morning. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Board Member Steele.
Thank you for meeting us today. I want to recognize my assessors in my district, their district, John Noguez in Los Angeles County, Webster Gilroy, one of my favorite assessors in Orange County, Ernie Dreinberg. We have a lot of actually new assessors just got elected last year from San Diego, Dennis Drager, San Bernardino County, Larry Ward, Riverside County, and Roy Buckner, Imperial County. I've been asking a lot of help from these assessors, and we've been working together, and my office is always open. And I know it's going to be hard that George to recognize all of his district assessors because he's so many. I have only six. You know, last August, I sent a letter out to Governor that stopped implementation of new fire fee on rural homeowners. It's going to affect about over 200,000 homeowners in third district because this fire tax violates Proposition 13. This Proposition 13 requires 2/3 vote for raising taxes, and I think fire fee is taxes. And then state from raising taxes from local purpose is prohibited too, and at the same time, these homes already paying fire taxes, so it's double taxation. And then we cannot even implement because we were not provided the funds to do so in our BOE. And I share these concerns with you because I believe the Proposition 13 is one of the best tax policy ever made in this state. And it protects taxpayers from a simply majority vote for tax increases and creates predictable, manageable property tax bills for California property owners and for assessors. And every step taken to weaken Proposition 13 threatens the entire structure of that constitutional amendment. Once the taxpayer protection in Proposition 13 are weakened or destroyed, it becomes easier to threaten other fundamental parts of the proposition, including the tax property tax cap through proposals such as the split role that we're going to talk about today. And this is not only a nightmare for the property owners, but also for assessors' offices in every county because it needs a lot of people to work on it. I believe it is necessary to work to uphold Proposition 13 and prevent legally questionable changes to could bring the entire structure down. And I've been working very closely with my assessors in my district for taxpayers, and I really appreciate that we're working very close together. And if you need any help in my office, please call anytime you need. And thank you very much. We are having a great meeting today.
Thank you very much. Mr. Renner, please.
Thank you, and welcome. It's good to be with you all. We appreciate the opportunity to come and talk together and highlight a couple of issues that we know are important to both your roles and also to ours. As Member Steele just said, I'm not going to go and list out the 32 assessors that, but welcome, and that are in my district. It's my privilege to serve the board as the chair of the Property Tax Committee, and I want to especially right now thank the property tax staff for helping to put together this event, and that has been, I think, a little bit different for them in the structure. I appreciate Chairman Horton and his thoughts, and as we work together to try to create a different kind of environment to have these discussions, and I think this will be proved to be very, very helpful. You know, it's really our goal, and I'm sure it's, as talking with many of you, it's your goal too, that to ensure that taxpayers are treated fairly and respected with respect at every level of government. It's been my effort. I think I've gotten to about maybe just over half of you new assessors in my district. We're still trying to finish up that by the end of the year, the first of next. But some of you are in some very far away places in California, and we are slowly getting to them all. But you know, one thing I've been impressed by as I have sat down and talked to many of you, and that is that your desire to truly be good administrators, fair administrators on tax policy for your citizens. And we want to continue to be of help and aid to you in that process. You know, I'm not going to take much time here because I'm anxious for us to get to the discussions that we're going to be dealing with. I just think it's going to be important for us to, as we hear these, to know that these are just a couple of the cutting-edge issues that we know that you are faced with and that are certainly, we know, that are looming out there. And I want to continue to thank you, and as we go through this process, I think there'll be much follow-up in regards to far more discussions in regards to other issues and other reforms that we need to put into place in order to protect California taxpayers. Thanks.
Member Mandel.
Thank you. It's nice to see everybody here today, and I bring greetings from State Controller John Chung. As you know, I represent Mr. Chung on this board, and he could not be here today, so I'm here for him. It's really nice to see a lot of people that I've known for a very long time. We have a new assessor in LA County, and as he reminds me every time he sees me, we first worked together about 25 years ago on a case, and he says I was right then. Don't know if it was the only time I was right, but it's nice that he remembers that I was right. Anyway, I wanted to take this opportunity to, since you're all here in one place, to give you my sort of annual reminder, which is when we have property tax issues that are coming before the board, you have, you know, information, factual information about how things work in your office or what you're seeing, or even whatever your arguments are for or against on a particular property tax issue coming before us, it's really great if we get that information sooner rather than, you know, for me, rather than the day before the board meeting, because the sooner I have the information, the better grounding I have and the controller has to figure out what we think about the issue that's coming before us. And I know I've said this, I think, every single year, and so people who've been around for a while, I think, you know, Larry probably sends a letter to Sacramento office, LA office, by fax, by email, every way possible, and we definitely get it. And you might think that's overkill, but I think it's great because you never know if I'm working in Sacramento or working in LA or whether we have a internal process of routing mail. Just make sure that we get it, and then it can factor into our consideration, and I really, really appreciate that. So I always say that I want to get right on going to the main event, always going last. Doesn't really cut my comments, but I am always eager to move on. So why don't we do that? Thank you.
Thank you very much, members. Want to extend an appreciation to John Nogas as well. He brought up the idea, his staff, to have a collaborative meeting where the county assessors is participating and interacting in the process. And along those lines, I want to introduce the president of the County Assessors Association, who has joined us here on the dais for an interactive, proactive discussion, Mr. Doug Wacker.
Thank you, Chairman Horton, and fellow board members. It's been a pleasure working with you and your board staff this past year as president of the California Assessors Association. Board staff has been very supportive and professional with the assessors and their staffs to promote fair and equitable assessments. As we move into this next year, I hope we can continue our good relationship so we may resolve issues which may become before us. At this time, it is my pleasure to introduce our 2012 CAA President, Tom Bordenaro Jr., San Luis Obispo County Assessor. Tom.
Thank you, Doug. And I want to thank the board for this meeting and acknowledge the staff that we work at through with the year. You have some hardworking staff that we rely upon in our association. Dean Kinney, Lisa Thompson, David Gao, and your legal staff. It's nice to see Christine up here. We like her in the legal department, but you can keep her here in that position because we think she's doing a fantastic job there too. But I really want to thank you for the working relationship that we have. I understand that it hasn't always been that way in the past, but it is a very positive relationship, one that I think we can still build upon. The association is a very diverse group. One thing I came out of the legislature, which, as you know, is quite nonpartisan, and you know everything they do is kind of above the board, you know. But going to the CAA and being on the legislative committee since my first coming into office, kind of noticed that it's a different group in that we have assessors from the far right to the far left and everywhere in between. But, you know, we still sit down and we still hammer out legislation. We still come to consensus and come to agreement. So it is possible. And I would like to see that relationship, and that's one of the things I admire most about the association, especially coming in from the outside into the assessment business. A fine group of professionals that will, they're problem solvers. We are not revenuers. We say that all the time. And, you know, but most people don't know the difference between the assessor and the collector. I kind of gave up trying to explain that in the district. People come up to me, I write you checks all the time. I said, well, no, you don't. The relationship that we have, I think, is very important, and to continue and to build on that, because there are some serious issues that are coming down the pike. Two of them we're going to be talking about today. There are others that are out there. I always have to throw in 462.040 as the rule. And I got to tell you, Dave Peets, where's Dave? Dave's hiding, because one of my very first conferences when this 462.040 came up, Dave volunteered me to head up an ad hoc committee, and that was about 9 years ago. So hopefully we could come to some sort of a consensus or agreement on reforming that. We do have a petition in the board that is before the board that's kind of on ice, which is a nice place for it to be, but hopefully we can broach that subject and work on that in next year. And you mentioned a little bit about funding in the assessor's offices. Many of us have been cut and slashed pretty bad. And, you know, with appeals and with the workload and backlog, we've tried to do a lot with technology, and I think many assessors have, using the website to better serve the people. But we're still, you know, we're still facing some serious times, especially when much of what we do ends up going to our schools who are in bad need of revenues. If we are not performing our job and the state has to come in and backfill those schools, I think there is statewide import to making sure that the assessors are funded to a level where we can get the job done. So far, I think we're doing a yeoman's job in making that happen. Doing more with less has become the mantra of governments at all levels. But at some point, I think that the state needs to step up and say, yes, we do have a stake in how well assessors are doing, and we need to be part of the solution instead of part of the problem. As Member Steele mentioned, the unfunded mandates, a little bit about, you know, the fire tax and other issues. I mean, where's Cal Fire going to go to get that data? They're going to come to us. And so that is going to be a staffing issue also at some point. So with that, I will pipe down, but I just appreciate the opportunity to be here and the working relationship with all of you, and continuing that and building on that into the future. Thank you.
Sure. Mr. Renner.
Thank you.
Well,
my
apologies. Let me sort of acknowledge, I don't have my glasses on, so my colleagues in the Senate and the Assembly, if any of you are here today, let me ask that you stand and come forth. If you'd like to share a word or two, please feel free to do so. As I often say, hearing and seeing none, I'm moving on. And let me thank you all for coming. As I look out into the audience and I see such a diverse group of intelligent, brilliant individuals who will make a huge difference here in the state of California, it excites me to be here, to participate in this hearing. And let me encourage you as well to be engaging and to actively participate. But let me share that this is just the beginning. There are a number of issues that we need to discuss and work with. I'm very fortunate to have worked with many of you while serving in the legislature on a number of different bills, dealing with the airlines, dealing with swimming pools, and a number of other property tax issues. But the two issues here before us today, embedded software and the split roll property tax, are issues that have been permeating in our society for a number of years. They are extremely important. There are diverse beliefs and thoughts on these particular issues, and I look forward to the debate today.
To lead us in that debate will be Mr. Runner. He is chair of the property tax, and he will take us through that process. But first, I'd like to call on Member Yee, who has a statement that she'd like to share.
Actually, I just wanted to respond to President-elect Bordenaro, and I know 462.040 has been an issue, and it continues to be. And we've been having, my office has been having conversations with various members of the legislature. I do believe that we will be able to get a bill introduced that looks at the co-ownership proposal that we had discussed several years back. And my hope is that as the bill moves through, that we can concurrently look at the rule petition as well. So I really don't want that to languish either. It's been difficult, and I certainly don't want the rule to be difficult for those who can benefit from it. But more importantly, we also don't want to see it abused either.
I appreciate that. Appreciate your efforts. I know because you have been probably since the day you came into office helping to work on that issue. So I appreciate that very much. I'm just trying to get rid of a committee that seems to never go away. So it's not often we're able to eliminate one of our ad hoc committees. But we're looking forward to that one.
I'll do the best I can to help.
All right. With that, we'll turn the gavel over to Mr. Runner.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Let me just go through what the ground rules are going to be as we have these discussions so that everyone understands how we're going to go through this process. We have panelists that will be coming up in these two topics. In fact, I'd like to invite the panelists that are in the first round to come on up and take their seats while I'm going through this discussion. You can see where your name tag is on this side and see if you can find the correlating chair on the other side, location. Let me just say what's going to happen is we're going to give the panelists 5 minutes to go through. I'll introduce them, and they'll give a five-minute presentation from a perspective that they have. Their first issue will be split role. At that point, then, we're going to transition to let the panelists, if they'd like, ask questions to one another of topics that may have come up in the discussion so the panelists can engage, and also the members on the dais and also from the Assessor Association will engage at discussion at that point. And then we'll let that go for a little bit. And if you can just let me know when you'd like to pipe in, I'll try to find you and bring some order to that. And then we're gonna go ahead and let the public respond. Public response we're looking for. Again, we're not sure exactly how many or how long this is going to go in terms of some of these discussions. So if you could be very focused on your comments, probably around 2 minutes. Try not to say something that somebody else has already said. And then I'll invite you at that time to, again, give your name and who it is that you represent. I'm kind of being the timekeeper here because we have two topics we want to get to. And so I'll try to keep us on track in regards to that and move along in that way. So that's what our process will be. Our first topic that we're going to be dealing with is split role. I'm not going to give it much of an introduction. I think we're all fairly familiar about the issues, concerns, the topics around it, but I'm going to go ahead and have the panelists go ahead and begin. I'm going to start with Jim Bickart. Jim is the Associate Director and off from the office of Mayor Antonio Villaraigosa's of the City of Los Angeles. Jim is a 35-year public policy veteran with experience in both public and private sectors, as well as community activism. He is the lead staff policy leader for the mayor on airports, animal welfare, zoos, and fiscal reform. He has also worked for the City of Los Angeles on transportation, land use, environmental, and infrastructure issues. In 1999 to 2000, he served as the executive director of the mayor's Blue Ribbon Commission on State and Local Government Finance. Jim, thanks for being, and you've got 5 minutes.
Thank you, Senator Renner, and thanks to the Board of Equalization for having us take part in this ongoing dialogue on the state's fiscal health. I'm here today representing Mayor Villaraigosa because he was in Sacramento back on August 16th. Talking about what he sees as a critical need to get serious about fiscal and tax reform in California before it's too late. To say he succeeded would be premature, but to say he garnered some attention for the topic would, I think, be accurate. After all, we're here today, and perhaps the mayor's speech played some small part in that. But the kind of substantive reaction Mr. Villaraigosa's speech engendered was frankly eyebrow-raising, beginning with the fact that it raised some eyebrows. Some folks simply said, in effect, how dare you even talk about this issue? It's too problematic, too unpopular, and too off-limits. Everybody knows that nobody wants anyone's taxes increased for any reason these days, even if the logic behind that sentiment is sometimes hard to fathom once one gets beyond the obvious. Some criticized the mayor for allegedly proposing specifics he didn't actually propose, almost as if their goal was to preempt any public discourse on the subject at all. Others discounted the policy angle and went for the political jugular, asking, what's he running for? Why didn't he just, doesn't he just go back to LA and mind the store there? This, of course, discounts the implications of state fiscal policy for local government that have been growing in importance ever since Proposition 13 was approved by the voters in 1978. To them, I ask in complete seriousness, what office do you think he's running for by speaking out on one of the most politically charged issues of our time? The answer is far from obvious. And I would add, only half in jest, perhaps he just wanted to put his tongue on the proverbial third rail of California politics to see if he could get a buzz. If so, I suspect he got what he was looking for. But as a matter of public policy, the mayor feels this is an issue whose time has long since come. That's because its implications not only for the solvency and viability of both state and local government, it's also about our ability to properly educate our children, maintain and expand vital infrastructure, and provide the public services a great majority of our people have over generation after generation come to expect and rely upon, from highways, harbors, and the social safety net to parks and prisons. He'd like to see policymakers and the public addressing how our unwillingness to engage on the issue leaves all levels of government regularly whipsawed by the fickle winds of economic fate when it comes to crafting workable budgets to do the people's business. He also wants the body politic to be talking about fundamental fairness and the hidden burden, arguable inequities in our tax system may be placing on many of the same people who claim that changing even one word of current law would somehow harm their interests, whether it would or not. If there are legitimate disagreements, let's air them out, hash through them, and see if we can separate fact from fiction. The failure to even talk about it ensures that we're likely to continue to make profound decisions not based on realities, but rather on assumptions, presumptions, and/or administrative, bureaucratic, or ideological prerogatives. When it comes to the interests of the state's various constituency, the mayor believes that our collective unwillingness to bite the bullet for sure serves some of them, but certainly not all of them. Today's topic is billed as being the split role, which was one of several possible angles on fiscal and tax reform Mayor Villaraigosa brought up in his speech. He didn't have a specific proposal to make at the moment and is prepared to consider the wisdom of everyone on all sides of the issue before deciding what to do or say next. So I join everyone in the room today in looking forward with great interest to whatever the members of this panel, all of whom are more expert on the subject than I, have to say for or against any aspect of it. Again, thank you for inviting me, and by implication, Mayor Villaraigosa, to participate today.
Thank you, Jim. Next, we have Rex Heim. Rex is president and CEO of California Business Properties Association. Rex helped to create the coalition that has stopped the threat of split rule several times. He has also provided leadership in the coalition of interests that has achieved passage of the law prohibiting commercial rent control in California, making it the only state to enact such legislation. Rex, thank you.
Thank you, Senator Renner, and certainly thanks to the board for allowing us to be here today. And for me, this is a major thrill, because normally I'm there looking up, and so to be able to look out, I can see how impressive all of the lobbyists and folks who come here to convert the legislators in their process must be. All right. So anyway, let me give you a little couple, 3 points, a little quick history. First and foremost, I want everybody to remember that when Proposition 13 was being campaigned on during the 1978 campaign, that the larger businesses, including the Chamber of Commerce, opposed Proposition 13. And it truly was a people's action that brought about the passage of that. And I think there are some on this panel and some who I've debated over the years, for instance, my good friend Lenny. And Lenny and I, by the way, just finished doing a great achievement by making California a bellwether state when it comes to collecting sales taxes on the internet. And we're very proud about that. But somehow, they sometimes like to say that a bunch of big scallywag business folks got together in a back room and came up with a way to scheme the property tax in California to their benefit. That's far from the truth. Now here we are many, many years later, and there have been another proposal after proposal after proposal to change Prop 13 into a split roll tax. Interestingly enough, though, the people who talk about split roll tax also talk about doing it with Prop 13. So it isn't just one that's a targeting business community, it's one that's ultimately targeting the entire application of Proposition 13 in our state. And that's a very important thing that everybody should remember when they discuss this issue. I also want to point out that business community has a very long and great relationship with our assessors. We happen to think that they are fine men and women who go through a very difficult process, and sometimes we end up being told we owe more, sometimes we end up being told we owe less. But the fact of the matter is, when there are scallywags, we want to work with the assessors to go after those folks. The majority of the business community is not here to protect those who would abuse Proposition 13 and the process that exists. And quite candidly, we have found that having the right kind of relationship with the assessors is very, very important in making sure that those who would abuse the process, none of which we're defending today, end up paying their fair share. So we think this opportunity today to have this kind of discussion is really important. Certainly, my vision, I was there on August 16th when the mayor did that. I didn't think he put his tongue on the third rail. Actually, it was more reminiscent of the Christmas thing where he put his tongue on that freezing pole, because it's a very difficult issue out there, and it's one that goes way beyond just the social and fiber and the economics of the state, but whether or not we're going to have any kind of future whatsoever.
Thank you, Rex. Our next speaker is Bill Harris. Bill is manager of property tax of Intel Corporation. Bill started with Intel as property tax manager in 2002. Prior to working with Intel, Jim has worked with a number of large corporations in California, including a Morton Salt Company, Levi Strauss, Memorex, and Lucky Stores, to name a few. Since joining Intel, Bill has been responsible for all property tax and property tax apportionment for state income tax. Bill is a member of the Institute of Professionals in Taxation and was chair of the Tax Committee for American Electronics Association in California for 2002 and 2003. Bill.
Thanks. Thank you. Thank you, Member Runner, and the remaining members of the board and the board staff. I'm going to talk today about one of the biggest issues in the split roll, and that has to do with how are we going to decide what's residential property and what's not residential property. This is probably the biggest issue. And one of the biggest parts of that issue is we have apartment houses, we have rental residential properties, and none of those are allowed to get the, they're all income producing. They would seem to fall into the residential property part, but on the other side of it, because they're income producing, are they really residential? If, for example, in the city of San Jose, if you have more than a duplex property, you have to have a business license and a permit to operate, or a residency permit. I'm not sure quite what the difference is. In the city of Folsom, if you have more than one rental property, you have to have a business license. So are they really residential properties? In some ways they are, and in some ways they aren't. But the question is, should income producing properties be considered residential property and therefore would not be bothered by the change of ownership if we went to a split roll? Or I mean, if we went to a split roll, they wouldn't be bothered by it because they would be, quote, residential property. One of the issues that just came up that I don't know if many people are aware, we just passed a law that changed the penalties for change of ownership.
And part of that law was the residential properties, if you don't do your change of ownership, and in most cases, residential properties aren't an issue because when you close, that's part of the paperwork that you sign. But the penalty was increased from $2,500 to $5,000. And on the other side, where you have business properties, that went from $5,000 to $20,000. And the interesting part of this whole law was residential properties are considered to be only those properties that have the homeowner's exemption. So what you're doing is you're saying the only residential properties out there are properties that get the homeowner's exemption. So that really kind of makes it very difficult to decide what is residential property. You know, we didn't make that law. The legislature made it, and they passed it. So if you're a single family, if for example, I happen to have a condo and I'm renting that condo, I don't get the homeowner's exemption. So if for some reason there was a change of ownership in that, if I didn't file, I'd get the bigger penalty. I wouldn't get the small penalty because it's not a homeowner's, you don't get the homeowner's exemption. So from that point of view, that makes this whole issue very interesting because you just, you know, how do you come up with it? You know, how do you really come up with this residential? We'd have to change the whole law as it stands right now, as far as the penalty goes, to decide what is residential property and what isn't. Now, to give you a little better example of this, over the years, starting in probably 1979 or 1980, the state board started to put together a spreadsheet that basically showed, they went through, they gathered all the assessed values for the entire state. And if you want to look at it, it's in everybody's folder. They put together all the assessed values for the entire state. They pulled out the tangible personal property and the utility properties, which aren't covered by Prop 13. Then they pulled out the properties that received the homeowner's exemption. And everything left was commercial, industrial, and all properties not covered or covered by Prop 13 that did not get the homeowner's exemption. They computed a percentage of homeowners occupied properties compared to other properties. And if you look at that on this spreadsheet that I have, you'll see that in the beginning in 1979, the homeowner-occupied properties were 51.2% of the total properties total Prop 13 properties. The non-homeowner, the commercial and industrial, were 48.8%. 2 years later, it changed drastically. Homeowners became 39.8%, and the non-homeowners were 60%. And as you can see, if you go down through that, that kind of fluctuates back and forth. And in 2009, I don't have 2010 yet. In 2009, homeowners were 38.6%, and the non-homeowners were 61.4%. And there's one other interesting column. If you look at column H, this is the percentage of homeowner-occupied properties, or those properties that get the homeowner's exemption, to the total assessed values across the state. And as you can see, it fluctuates between 33% and 36%. It went up to 38, 39, it's dropped back down to 36. So the real problem with split roll is how we're gonna deal with this, what's residence and what's everything else. What's a home, you know, is a residential property gonna be an apartment, or do we say anything that's income producing isn't a residential property? That's going to be the real question.
Good. Thank you. Our next speaker is Lenny Goldberg. Lenny is Executive Director of California Tax Reform Association. In that role, he has been involved with major tax legislation in California for the past 15 years. He has directed and worked on a number of statewide tax initiative campaigns. He's owner of Lenny Goldberg and Associates, public interest consulting and lobbying group, which has also been involved with energy, consumer housing, and human service issues. He has a degree in economics from Williams College and the University of California, Berkeley. Lenny.
Thanks. Well, thank you very much. I'm in hog heaven today, And partially, let me pick up on several of the things that were said, and I'll try to tell, I'm going to have to talk very fast to get my issues in. Jim Bickhart raised the question of public discourse. The only thing that I think we should need to seek right now is public discourse on the question of assessments of non-residential property. And so I'm also really happy, and we can engage this in the later discussion, that Bill Harris has raised these issues, because I think there are a lot of questions about and issues that are embedded in much of the data we've looked at. I also had said to staff that I didn't want to focus on this as a question of split role, because split role implies a solution. And I think before you get to a solution, you want to identify the problem. And so I want to thank the forbearance of many of the assessors here, Larry Stone in particular, and others who we bother all the time about data and issues, Dan Goodwin as well. But what is the problem? And one of the problem trying to deal with the problems of assessors is that as we have looked at a lot of the ownership of property, it's extremely complex on the commercial side. And that is, and it's almost that every property has a story. We've looked at deeds of trust in which trust ownership has changed hands, but there's been no change of ownership. LLCs, where you're, the underlying owners change hands, but there's no change of ownership. Leasehold interests, where private equity firms buy entire hotel chains, let us say, but many of those have underlying leasehold interests. Did a change of ownership take place or didn't it? When an IP, when a company is closely held and then goes with an IPO, has a change of ownership occurred? Well, no, it hasn't by law. One would say, as a matter of common sense, that the owners, the vast number of owners of these properties have changed hands. So you have incredible complexity. Every property has a story. Is there enough information there? Well, there may be enough information there, but because of the complexity of the law, which requires 50 plus 1%, not 10 owners selling to 10 owners, other owners, is not a change of ownership by current law. An 100% buyout, a 99 or 95% buyout is not a change of ownership. An IP, taking a company private and then selling it again to the public, if it's structured correctly, is not a change of ownership. So we need to look at the underlying law and say what makes sense here. Second thing is that there really is an arbitrary distribution of the tax burden. We've looked at, and in particular, and this is an interesting question when you start looking at quote-unquote solutions, because we've heard from the assessors that reassessing all commercial property, and I take that very seriously, would be a very difficult job. One of my colleagues who may speak here says, go back 20 years and take the oldest first and bring them up. That may be one of the solutions. Another one, which, and it's very interesting from the data, what you find is that land values are incredibly disparate, and the underassessment, we're talking about 1975 land values. Now, if you take many, and we've looked at a bunch of high-tech companies, if you look, those companies are not going to be using 1975 buildings. So when we look at the differences in buildings and structures, you find that the, let's say from hotels, the disparities are not very great. What you find are huge disparities, 3 cents versus $1.50. In San Francisco, $2 a square foot on tax versus $15 a square foot in competitive businesses. And it turns out that any hotel is going to keep rehabilitating and refurbishing and will be reassessed as new construction. But you're going to find, you find incredible disparity in the land value. So when we talk about solutions, and I really appreciate Jim Bickhart, or by reference Antonio Villaraigosa's comments, there are a number of problems here that need to be solved. Now, when I've suggested, for example, the concept of split role is generally reassess commercial property. Well, if you were to say reassess land values of commercial property, you would A, find a problem, not as great, nowhere near as great a problem going in and looking at every structure. And you would find that many of the disparities and inequities in the system between competitive and comparative businesses, between small businesses and large, would probably be eliminated or greatly diminished in something that the assessor can do. Now, when I've suggested to the economists that a trade-off might be reassess land values and eliminate the personal property tax, which is a tax on new investment, as opposed to land values which occur as a result of other people's investment, what are called economic rents, you could not find an economist who would not say that makes, you know, the one-handed economists, they're all on the same side here. That makes complete sense. Take the burden off new investment and tax economic rents. So there's an economic discussion to be had. There's a data discussion to be had. There is a county by county, a looking at what that data looks like in each county discussion to be had. And I couldn't be happier with the notion if there is a concerted effort to really lay out the data. We started to do that as a result of one assessor's meeting with Member Yee. And let's really look at the data. Let's look at these properties. I'm not sure if this made it into a bit of our report on Silicon Valley properties, if it's in your folders or not. But you know, every time we put some numbers out, actually many of our numbers have not been attacked as inaccurate, but it's a very difficult, complex process. We would love to have a discussion that really looks at data, that really looks at the nature of the different forms of ownership. I have here a presentation of the Beverly Hills Bar done by a beautiful presentation done by the Board of Equalization, one reflecting something that Christy Kazad did a number of years ago, which is pages and pages on the complexities of how to determine change of ownership. I think that's bad law, and we need to look at the problem and move on.
Thank you. Thank you, Lane. Our last speaker on this panel is Dan Goodwin. Dan is the Ventura County Assessor. He was first elected Assessor of Ventura County in 1998 and has been reelected three times. He has over 40 years of experience in public assessment and private appraisal in the private appraisal industry. Dan managed his own appraisal and accounting firm for over 16 years, during which time he earned the appraisal industry's highest designations. He has served as president of the Ventura and Santa Barbara County Chapter of Appraisal Institute of the California of the Appraisal Institute, and is a past president of the California Assessors Association. Dan.
Thank you, Senator Runner, and thank you, honorable members of the board. Appreciate always the opportunity to work with you and see the energy that you put into a successful California through assessors and property tax administration done well. One thing I really appreciate about Mr. Goldberg's presentation is I was thinking as I was listening, wow, the people that have to administer all that stuff must really be doing a good job, because generally speaking, California is moving along pretty smoothly. So every one of the assessors, thank you for patting us on the back, Lenny. We are administrators. That's essentially one of the areas that I wanted to address. And we are each independent individuals. Each assessor in this room comes to their assignment with a perspective primarily focused on applying California property tax law correctly. We all have some opinions that slightly vary, so the things that I share may not exactly be 100% of their point of view, but generally speaking, I think it'll reflect what most assessors see. This issue was also before your board 2 years ago, in August of 2009. In fact, I was present that year, so I was kind of doing what Senator Runder is doing now and coordinating the discussion. And so this, you know, it's had serious attention for a while, a split role. And one of the things that certainly is clear is there are a variety of thoughts that come to mind when that issue comes up, because it isn't clear what would be an approach. And one of the things I've never really heard defined well is, well, what's really the goal of this? I mean, is this only about revenue? Is this only about some kind of different fairness issue? Is this about, well, gee, what approach? There's going to be winners and losers, and unfortunately in Sacramento a lot of issues are affected by who's a winner, who's a loser. Is there is there a body of constituents behind this? Well, obviously, homeowners are substantial. Homeowners are where most of the votes are. And so it's almost by implication, and it's understood that, well, we, you know, if something's going to be a change to Prop 13, the opinions of homeowners and the letting homeowners not be a loser anyway, they may not be winners, but certainly keeping them from being losers, always seems to be a part of various approaches. So then, okay, we've been talking about it a while. There's lots of approaches, pros and cons now on different kinds of approaches have been expressed by a lot of the stakeholders, a lot of the interested parties. And I think what happens to assessors is we start, as we hear these various proposals, we start thinking about consequence. And there's some that are known, and there's some that are unknown. And of course, the unknown are ones, we happen to have Dan Walters as a speaker yesterday at our conference, and one of the things he brought up is if he ever writes a book, he'll probably write it on the impact of unintended consequences. And so, you know, that's, you know, whatever I would propose that if there were a major change to Prop 13, that there will be some things that we can anticipate, but there will be some unintended consequences as well. And certainly perceptions are going to be a big part of that. Oftentimes what's real difficult to analyze is what is the public perception, what is business perception. You know, the economic climate we're in now, so many business decisions are made based upon a perception of, you know, will my business succeed? None of us, even though I get a regular check from the county, I'm not going to invest in a company. I'm not buying RIM stock right now. You know, Research in Motion, just, you know, it's gone down a whole lot. But, you know, my perception, so that same thing comes to how people make business decisions about, am I going to build a factory or am I going to start a new business? Am I going to buy land in Ventura County and develop something? And whether it be manufacturing to tourist oriented, all that's based upon a perception. So I think we also need to keep an idea as we talk about a split role issue, if it's totally about maximizing a revenue option, and we find ourselves punishing business who eventually has to pass along the cost of taxes, just like electricity, insurance on the property, and everything else, all has to be passed along somewhere. I mean, it's ultimately paid for by the person who buys the widget or pays for the service that's coming out of that property. So, and the apartment issue, I'm glad somebody, I think it was, Mr. Harris spoke about the apartment issue and residential. What is definition? A lot of things about defining property, what would be under a split role would be an issue. Clearly, as an administrator, if we were to go to the one concept of let's just reassess on some kind of regular cycles, everything non-residential. Once we've got past defining what's the residential and what's the not, those are the more complex properties. The labor hours involved in appraising an office building, a hotel, a shopping center, those are more labor hours involved. So there's going to be an issue of just allocating resources and that kind of thing. Certainly the appeals will be more substantial. Another area, the split role, I think, you know, the split role is the rate change as a split role. Trying to figure out some kind of a alternative rate for one type of property versus another, labor hours aren't going to be as great, but there will still be an impact on assessors because it'll become very critical. Is a assessor site use code identify a property under one use versus another? Is it going to get the higher rate, the lower rate? And that could be a substantial dollar decision that's made. So a lot of issues about that. You know, another thing, it's interesting, a little story to bring up. Back in 1999, when I was a brand new assessor, I met with Jack O'Connell, who at the time was the state senator in my county. And I was telling Jack, why don't you guys produce a presentation for the legislature to increase the homeowner's exemption? I was, as a young appraiser back in the 70s, I started my career in the assessor's office in the 70s. It was $7,000 in 72 for a homeowner's exemption.
Dan, I'm going to ask you to kind of wrap up so we get our discussion portion.
I've only got another half hour to go, but I'll wrap it up.
Okay. Well, I thought I'd give you
Thank
notice.
You. Thank you. I can wrap it up. I think you get the idea. There are a large number of issues tied to this. It probably is the kind of thing where I could talk an hour and then every other assessor could keep on going. So thank you, sir,
thank you. Thank you for our panelists.
What we want to do now is to have a discussion. I don't know if there were some comments made from one panelist to another or to the, in the presentation that might have brought a question to mind by another panelist. And certainly for board members and also from the Assessors Associations, there's some clarifying questions that we'd have. But we'd like to take a few minutes right now to kind of engage in that discussion and follow-up questions. So, yes, Mr.
Harrison. I'd like to make one point. It seems like there's some question about whether properties are reappraised or whether businesses really get reappraised. When I worked for Lucky Stores in 1988, in June of 88, we were acquired by American Stores. We had over 500 properties in the state of California. The ones that were reappraisable, the ones that we owned, the ones that had more than 35 years in their leases plus options, those were all reappraised. In 1999, they were, American Stores was acquired by Albertsons. And again, all those properties that were still there that were owned or had 35 years or more on lease were reappraised. And then in 2004, 2005, all those stores were sold again. And again, they were all reappraised. And that's one example. And you talk about commercial property. That's exactly what it is. Those properties, including the land and everything, those were all reappraised. And they're fairly, I would say, if you looked at all the stores that used to be Lucky Stores, they're all fairly close to market value, maybe over market value because mm-hmm. of the drop in 2008 and 2009. But, I mean, that's an example, and Lucky Stores wasn't the only one.
Okay. Lenny.
Yeah, I would pick up on that example, and I also want to comment on Bill's previous issue on the residential. When Save Mart bought Albertsons, perfect example, some of them were reappraised and some of them were not. Now, on what basis are we, you know, running a tax system in which, because of the nature, a complex underlying leasehold situation, there you see some pay higher taxes and some not? Does that, can anyone rationalize that other than that's what we've, you know, bought into? Hilton Hotel chain brought by Blackstone Group, and some of them are reappraised and some of them are not, and they have complex underlying operating leases. What rationale is there to that? The value of the Hilton Hotel is the value of the Hilton Hotel. On the residential, non-residential question, I think the only gray areas really are things like residential hotels, because I think you can define that. I think law already defines that. But one of the interesting things I just want to comment on the data, and Bill Harris raised this, that there is a large residual in the data when you look at it that's somewhere between 15 and 19 or 20% that are single-family properties, whether condos or homes, without homeowner's exemptions, as he mentioned. Are those businesses or are they not? I would argue that that it's not difficult, and there's a lot of law that defines residential, non-residential. There is a case to be made that some apartment property really is business and investment property. But when we looked at the data, and thank you, Board of Equalization, because you had all the assessors' reports going back to the 1970s, that when you divide what the assessors report as residential, non-residential, and those are pretty consistent for over many years, you find in 55 of the 58 counties there has been a significant shift, not specifically to homeowners, but to residential property and away from commercial property.
Okay. Mr. Bernal.
Just real quick, I know Mr. Goldberg mentioned in the beginning that, you know, what is the problem is what we ought to be addressing. Well, I might suggest we need to back up from that a little bit, because I'm not convinced that there is a problem. So maybe the question is there a problem? And if there could be some sort of consensus come to that, then I would imagine that the answers would probably fall from that. I mean, the data, I've seen data on both sides of this issue, and I'm not sure that, I am sure that the jury is still out on whether there is a problem. Especially, you know, when you look at some of the data. So maybe that's where we ought to be starting from, not what is the problem, because that implies that there is one.
Well, the one thing I might respond to Lenny is when you start talking about the leaseholds, the 35 years, you know, business, and we didn't make that up. That came from the legislature. 35-year, if you have more than 35 years on a lease, that's a change of ownership. If you have less, it's not a change. We didn't make that up. I'm not saying it's right or wrong, but the legislature made that up. They passed the law in 1978, and that's what it was. Now, I'm sure that when they were putting all that together, there was some disagreement about what it should be, but they came up with 35 years. Perfectly reasonable.
Mr. Heim, I think we're
I was just going to say, I'm in hog heaven now because I heard Lenny say that he was up for some discourse. And I happen to think that's something that we have sadly lacked in this whole arena. Usually the campaigns are those who, you know, evil corporate black hat people are not paying their fair share, and we need to change that. And also I think having real discourse keeps us from following into the trail of some of the efforts which wanted to say anytime a publicly traded business sold or traded 50% plus one of their stock cumulatively, that they should be reassessed. A bill that Mr. Goldberg was very happy about. And that would mean, for instance, all of our high-tech companies would be reassessed perhaps as many as 5 or 6 times a year because their stock is constantly traded. And it doesn't change who runs Dell or HP or any of that kind of stuff. And yet, that's some of the measures. So having discourse, I think, is really important, Lenny. I would love to engage you in that discourse, not from across tables in the sense of this is where we're going to go to the ballot box and this is what we're going to do. I think the issue of what is and isn't residential is really important. I think most folks believe that if you are producing income from your property, it is not a residential property. It's a commercial property because that's how you define commercial property. It produces income. It's designed to generate income. So, and I know that specifically for political reasons, you've had to leave out those apartments because you don't want those voters saying no to your proposals. So having that good discourse, being together with you in Hog Heaven, is something I look forward to.
I'm going to skip to Member Yee. Hang on just a minute. We'll get back to you. Member Yee, I think, had some input, and then we'll get back to Mr. Goldberg.
Great. Thank you, Senator Runner. I want to focus on the responsibility of the board and the assessors in this whole discussion. And regardless of where split role proposals may arise, I think the board and the assessor community ultimately have the responsibility for how we're going to make it work. And I actually agree with all the comments that each of the panelists has offered today, because it's really, you know, what's your beginning frame of reference? And no doubt split role proposals will arise in probably a very highly political context. And I also welcome public discourse on the issue, but I want informed public discourse on the issue, which to me, the first step really needs to be, how do we resolve the conflicts that we have in data? How do we resolve the conflicts that we have among the studies that have been done? And how do we begin to get our arms around some of these definitional issues? I think we're doing ourselves and the public a great disservice if we can't really resolve those issues. Because whatever the goal is, whether it's to provide greater tax equity, whether it's generating additional revenue, whether it's trying to influence some economic impact, we can't answer or even meet any of those goals until we have some comfort and hopefully some agreement about what the data suggests. So I really want to, and Lenny, I want to thank you for taking up the charge from 2 years ago, because I think there's more work to do in the data area. I will tell you, this board, I don't feel comfortable with this board putting out any numbers relative to a revenue estimate or economic impact for any split role proposal that I would feel confident about backing, given where we are with the data and studies today.
Okay, let me just do this real quick. I'm going to have 2 last comments, and we went over to the public. Mr. Goldberg, you want to make a quick response,
and I'm going to go to the new incoming president of the Assessors Association, Mr. Bordenaro. I agree with you. I think the we have seen that if we propose something like If it's 100% change of ownership, no matter how many shareholders, it should be considered a change of ownership, that you get a letter that has 150 businesses opposing that discussion. So it's highly politicized. I really would love this discussion to back off from the highly politicized and say, give me the opportunity to show you that there is a problem. And I'll, as one example, IBM is in Silicon Valley is paying half a cent per square foot in tax on its land. Adobe up the road is paying $1.14 a square foot, or 228 times what on the land what IBM is paying. New companies are coming in, and the burden is hit of new investment is falls on the new on the tax burden falls on new investment, whereas everyone else benefiting doesn't pay that. And even if you put in a highway interchange, you have that problem.
Okay.
So I want to have the, if we can have the discussion of, is there a problem? What is the problem? That, you know, we'd love to get out of the politicized environment of this discussion.
Okay, and I want to go to Assessor Goodwin real quick, but before he starts, I'm going to invite the public. I've got a couple of cards for those who wanted to speak. You don't need to do a card to speak. So if you could start lining up right here while Mr. Goodwin starts making his responses, that way we'll go right to the public after that. So come on down. You're going to be speaking at the podium right down here.
Don't knock each other down rushing up here.
I do have a couple of cards, so I assume people are coming. But I need you to kind of be ready so that we're using up our time wisely here. So just kind of be ready to go. And Dan, go ahead.
Thank you, Senator. You know, just real quickly on Mr. Goldberg's comment, cost of capital, businesses always compete, and when they require assets, and that's part of their project model. I think Member Yee brought up a good question about why some of the data, some of the indicators range. There's some consistency issues. I think basically a consistent set of assumptions will go a long ways towards building more predictable outcomes, and the same thing goes with also a better understanding of the facts. Sometimes some of the research projects that have come out are, there's a lot of opinion that was used as opposed to really understanding the facts, and that's the advantage assessors have. They're the ones who are living in the mix of the facts. One illustration, I'd like to bring up a concept that nobody's talked about that is part of the picture that's been missed, and that is a little theory I have about, has Prop 13 actually raised the overall assessed role in the state of California among all the counties? And think about this concept. First of all, a couple things have happened. Prop 13 created predictability of taxes, which also created stability in the market for all property types, particularly residential. There's a lot of folks who stayed in their homes and didn't add them to the market pool because they didn't want to lose their tax base. Now, in a market like we've had the last 3 years, can you imagine how stressed it would have been on top of the foreclosure, you know, the loan problem properties that are available to be put on the market? We also had people who no longer could pay their tax bills, so you had an additional increment of supply. We'd be even further down. Another part of this theory is my wife and I bought our second house in 76 for $63,000. Well, it got to the point of being well worth more than $600,000. We still live in that house. Now, I don't know that it would appreciate it without Prop 13 because of the overall supply-demand situation and what was going, the tax issue. I really think my house never would have got to as high a value. I think part of California's superior or higher property values in general are partially the beneficiary of Prop 13, which means even if, so if you think about it, now this is a theory not a lot of people have thought about, but if you think about it, if we had a traditional cycle that we had pre-Prop 13, taxes were a bigger impact. That's a part of the payment. Everybody knows when you borrow, there's a tax increment, a insurance increment, and a principal and interest amortization increment. And that's your purchasing power. And that goes towards the bottom line of what properties are paid for. Well, by the over the trend of time, I think California's overall role, even with Prop 13, is actually higher than it would have been if we never had Prop 13. Another illustration of that right now.
But you got to
know this. This is most important. Prop 8 right now.
Real quick.
Probably between 25% and 30% of the state is in Prop 8 conditions right now, which means they're actually valued at market value below their Prop 13 maximum. And that's where the real revenue for the state is when that is recaptured, when there's that chase of the held down values, when that's all recaptured and put in the roll, that's when you're going to have your slingshot effect on your tax bill.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. I'm going to ask the public to come on up. If you'll just come right up to the front here. We're already behind, so I'm going to go ahead and just give name and represent and just a couple of observations, please.
Dave Dorr, California Taxpayer Association. One thing that always bothers me about this discussion is the assumption that property tax or values are the same per square foot. Values of property are based on replacement costs, new less depreciation, comparable sales, and income, so that you can have properties the same square footage that have vastly different values. And this idea of equating values per square foot, I don't think helps the discussion.
Okay, thank you.
That's true.
Thank you. Mr. Wolf, are you ready to? And somebody else can come right up to the, come up here. Come on, there's two spaces, come on up.
Jennifer Bester, mom, native Californian, puzzled voter, amateur property tax researcher. I got puzzled about the low amount that was able to be spent per student in my basic aid district. And so I started researching property tax rolls. I'm a good customer of a number of people out there in the audience. If you're interested in what a mom is interested in, I've got one copy of each. I did some analysis on Beverly Hills. In looking at the specific rolls, I think it's actually very easy, Mr. Harris, to answer your question about residential. I think that's a problem that this group could tackle. Because property taxes fund local schools, and those schools are what drive our economy. For me, as the mother of a child, the economy of California is the most important thing. We have set up a very uneven playing field with Prop 13 against new businesses against expanding businesses. Intel must care about this. I'd love to know what Intel's official stance on Prop 13 is, especially for long established companies like Intel, because Intel is the sixth largest sponsor of H-1B visas and green cards in the nation. So somehow Intel has not been able to find 12,000 Americans in the last decade who could do the work that they need. Science and technology is very expensive in education because we have to compete with I'm just a mom. We have to compete with the private sector. Now, when I've looked, my detailed analysis has approximated Santa Clara County's published figures. 40% to 50% of property owners, both residential and commercial, I don't think we have to cut between those two, are paying 60% to 70% of the burden for local services, schools, courts, police, fire, etc. So 40% to 50% are watching 30% of their property tax dollar go to subsidize another group. When I look down at the core of about 20%, particularly in commercial property,
I'm going to be asking you to wrap it up.
Great. I find Easy Street, Mr. Runner, not Main Street. I find impenetrable partnerships, heirs of former businessmen, large real estate investment companies, limited liability companies, when I call them to ask them for a contribution to our local educational foundation, I am met with stunned amazement that they should be considered in any way part of our local community. California commercial property, particularly among those with a 35-year basis, is simply a favored investment.
Thank you. Thank you. Mr. Wolf.
Senator Hunter, board members, David Wolf here with the Howard Jarvis Taxpayers Association. And just to speak to the earlier comment, first and foremost, per pupil spending adjusted for inflation over the 33 years since Prop 13 has passed has increased 30%. 30%. Don't tell me that there's not enough money to fund education. Or if you are going to say that, don't blame it on Prop 13. It's simply not the case. Just to keep it simple, California's had a unified commercial and residential property tax rate for 33 years. It was always the intent of Proposition 13, even dating back to the ballot measures, ballot arguments in 78, that this be the case. Increasing the 1% cap would be, for commercial property, would be a split roll, and it is a tax increase. And further, ladies and gentlemen, it's not what voters want. There was a field poll that came out last month that showed 63% support for Proposition 13. It should be noted it passed in 1978 with 66% of the vote. 33 years later, we're in exactly the same spot as we were 33 years ago. It's also worth noting that support for a split roll is also struggling, depending on which poll you read, to achieve majority support, and that's going to make it very hard to get it passed as a result of an initiative measure on the ballot. And just finally, members, just to make this point, we can afford the dialogue, and I thank you for this dialogue this morning. It's been very helpful and a very good discussion. What we can't afford is higher property taxes with 2 million Californians out of work.
Thank you.
And for that reason,
thank
ask
you.
For no
thank you.
Support.
I'm Phil Ting. I'm the assessor recorder in San Francisco. Prior to my time as assessor recorder, I worked in the real estate industry for Arthur Anderson, CB Richard Ellis, as well as a realty advisory company that bought apartment buildings for CalPERS and CalSTRS. First of all, just to talk about Mr. Wolf's, I think, stat about per pupil spending, which I think is an excellent point. We spend on average about $9,000 per pupil. In San Francisco, we're fortunate. We spend about $10,000 per pupil. On average, that ranks us toward the very bottom quartile in the country. We are competing with states in the South, states that do not, we consider our economic peers. If you look at New York and New Jersey, they spend about $18,000 or $16,000 per pupil. If you want to get a private school education, I know things are a little more expensive in San Francisco, it costs you about $23,000 to get a private school education in San Francisco. So clearly some families think it is worth it to spend more per family. According to field polls or any polling around split roll issues, what we've seen is depending on how you ask the question, you get a very different answer. If you ask the question, should commercial property owners pay more, you get a very different answer than should residential property owners pay less than commercial property owners. And what we've seen before is that actually, once you ask that question, you do get upwards of 60%. Split roll is also, in terms of the notion, it's not a notion that is uncommon across the United States. Over 20 plus states actually have some form of different taxation for commercial and residential property. I think many of the questions are very excellent to be asked. I'm glad that we're having this dialogue, and I think it's important that we could even look at many of those states to clarify that. Another proposal that wasn't mentioned that could be looked at is what many states do is they actually grow residential properties and commercial properties at different rates. Instead of having a flat 2% rate, you have different rates for commercial or residential. That would be something that would be very easy to implement for us as assessors. I totally agree with my colleague, Mr. Goodwin, that we do want to be careful not to change too much in order to create this burden of unassessable properties. And I think lastly, just to hammer two final points, I think change of ownership, I know that obviously resides in the legislative definition, but I think that's one of the worst things about Proposition 13. It really turns us from assessors into lawyers. I know I don't like my city attorney that much to be talking to them all the time about changing ownerships. I could probably echo many of my other colleagues that so much of our time now is spent determining whether something's even accessible, whereas our job really is not really to care about whether something's accessible or not, but should be really just to value property, which is what it used to be. And I think the last point that I want to echo is Mr. Goldberg's point. I think that Prop 13, the way it is, actually hurts new businesses. And the way you look at it now is if you are a new business and you buy a new property, you are at a competitive disadvantage if you happen to buy an identical property next to somebody who's owned it for 30 years. Your property taxes are usually tenfold. Your overhead is significantly higher, and it makes it almost impossible to compete in today's marketplace. So therefore, we've created a marketplace where we've actually shutting out new investors, new property owners, because frankly, they can't compete. Ms. Bester is very modest. One of her best examples that she talks about in Menlo Park is Trader Joe's versus Drager's. And Trader Joe's is able to, through, I believe, through the law, but also through a huge loophole, pay very little in property taxes. Yet, if I go to that Trader Joe's, my milk is not any cheaper, my eggs aren't cheaper, and my butter's not cheaper, because really, those property tax savings should be trickling down to me as a consumer. But they're not, because the pricing is exactly the same as every single other Trader Joe's in the region. And I think that's one of the problematic problems, is that property tax savings really should be given back to us as citizens, as taxpayers, but really they're not.
Okay, thank you very much. And I want to thank the panelists. Now that we've solved split rule, we want to move on to embedded software. But I'm going to ask us to take a quick 2-minute break. We're going to switch off some people here and some name tags, and we'll move on to embedded software. Thank you.
Good, good. We're winning so far.
Hello, hello. There we go. Is that on? There we go. Okay, our panelists, please take their seats. Other folks can take their seats. We're going to move on to...
Could everyone please find their seats?
No.
Uh-oh.
Put her after, I think.
That's fine. Yeah, I have a 2 o'clock
flight. Yeah. Okay, we're going to go ahead and move on now. The second panel discussion that we'll follow the same process on is the on the assessment of embedded software. The legislature enacted statutory provisions in 1972, which provided that all computer software except basic operational programs is exempt from property tax. To assist the implementation of that legislation, the board created property rule 152. Then in 2008, the Court of Appeals, the Cardinal Health versus County of Orange, opined that non-basic operational software that was bundled or embedded inside computer when is delivered to the customer is not taxable. Obviously, there's ongoing discussions on this issue. We have a group of people who are going to now help us with this. The first panelist is Peter Michaels, attorney at law, Peter Michaels Law. Peter is primarily responsible for big business and exempt organizations in California state and local tax matters. He has represented many industries, including telephone companies, cable, television systems, internet providers, and so on. He has also worked closely with local boards and supervisors, county, city councils, assessors, and county managers on property tax matters. Peter, please go ahead and begin.
Thank you very much. Thank you. I was asked to address embedded software and how the valuation, the segregation of value attributable to embedded software affects state assessees. That's mostly public utility companies, and as you all know, those state assessees are annually assessed by this Board of Equalization and are not subject to the limitations of Prop 13. So we take an annual look at this issue now, of course. I wanted briefly just to identify the industries that are subject to state assessment and then briefly give you a feeling for how embedded software, how important, relatively speaking, embedded software is to these categories of state assessment, state assessees. They're local phone companies, the former incumbent local phone companies that are state assessed. They're inter-exchange phone companies. They used to be long-distance phone companies. They're assessed by the board. Wireless companies are, telephone companies are assessed by the board. Gas and electric utilities are assessed by the board. Inter-county pipeline companies and railroads. And embedded software, to a greater or lesser extent, has is a huge driver in the operation of each of those categories of industry. Now, the concept of a public utility in the first place is a 20th century concept. We don't have public utilities as we did in the 20th century. And the three first categories I identified, local telephone, inter-exchange telephone, wireless telephone, we don't have telephones anymore. And I usually get corrected when I use the word telephone because we live in an era of telecommunications. So whereas the model we're working with used to apply to monopolies, it's now deregulated, it's now competitive, and a lot of the horsepower, brain power of the industries, again, to a greater or lesser extent, lies in the embedded software. I want to mention that we work with the State Assessed Properties Division very closely, especially for the larger utilities and state assessees, and They are receptive. I think they're reasonable. We've had lots of conversations, obviously, both on assessment issues per se and valuation issues. But I think there's an advantage state assessees have on the valuation side because the State Assessed Properties Division is very knowledgeable relatively speaking, quite sophisticated on some of these complex property valuation issues. So we are happy to have a receptive staff. Briefly, and I tried to look at this from perspective of replacement cost new. Relatively speaking, how much of a percentage is embedded software to the overall replacement cost new or the overall value of some of these utility industries, just to get a feel. And in some industries, it's not, I don't know the answer, or I didn't do it, I couldn't do it, but in others, I did get information that gives us a feel for where we are or you know, where we're headed. Again, just briefly, to revisit local exchange and the former incumbent phone companies, the Ma Bells, they used to require central offices. Those central offices used to be 15,000, 25,000 square feet. That functionality can now be provided with a desktop. They don't need 15 or 30. In fact, they've got all this super adequate space. But that's a separate matter. It shows you how much of the value, how much of a shift there has been in our economy, in the way we do business. And of course, the local phone company used to be land-based and terrestrial. Now that's your video company, that's your internet service provider. You get data. It's almost as if voice is an afterthought at this point. And the same is true for long distance. Those are internet transport companies now. You don't make long distance phone calls. And so they are transporting data, especially the former long distance phone companies. Embedded software is driving what they're transporting, and voice and video too. And it's obvious that wireless is largely driven by application software, and wireless is taking over, and we can see with our own eyes because they're actually discrete applications. moving to the lesser technological industries that are assessed by the state, gas and electric. Well, the smart meter is here to stay, that's for sure. And the big utilities here in the state that provide electric service already have smart meters, and they're, unlike some of the other industries, and this is, I think, an important point in this conversation, the ability to isolate or segregate value for the embedded software, therein lies the rub. It's pretty tough to do on the telecom side. It's a lot easier for a smart meter, and in fact, the gas and electric utilities have made a specific objective or a point of isolating value attributable to embedded software in smart meters. So we're actually going to be able to, I think, see some good record keeping and some good data that will enable us to make what's otherwise a fairly difficult, sometimes
I'm
impossible.
I'm going to hate to be the bad guy here, but if you could.
Oh, really? My 3 minutes is up?
No, you've gone five, so it's.
Pipelines, inter-county pipelines are now basically run by what's called control and data software. That amounts to about 10% of their RCN nowadays, probably about 10% of what they're spending is on embedded software. And railroads, there are now emerging green railroads. The railroads are probably at somewhere in the neighborhood of 15% of their RCN, their replacement cost, their value is tied to embedded software.
Okay. Thank you. Next speaker is Tom Parker, Colusa County Council. Tom was appointed to Colusa County Council in 2010. He has worked in county government since 1991, including El Dorado, Sacramento, and Colusa counties. Tom has handled county assessor, county auditor and controller, and county tax collector issues since 1994. He is past chair of the statewide Association of County Councils, state taxation committee, and chair of County Councils Association property tax and the study group. He is currently a member of the governing board of the County Councils Association. Tom.
Thank you, Senator. I want to very quickly thank the members of the board for allowing me to participate in this and for having this discussion. I've been involved with the state board since 1998 on various things, and it's always been a great pleasure to work here before and discuss items with the board. I don't disagree at all with the importance of the embedded software. In fact, I fully endorse the importance that Ms. Peter here has stressed in his presentation. What I would say, since I deal with the local assessment side as opposed to the state assessment side, the impact of what is and is not embedded software and how it gets valued has a greater proportional impact, in my view, at the local level than at the state level. I say that because your typical state SSE is in the multi-millions or in the billions of dollars in terms of total assessment on their statewide property. And that's how the state board does their assessment business, the statewide unitary model. Local is obviously very different. It's what's only in that county. So the embedded software becomes a real bigger problem and issue. The current statutes, 995, 995.2 of the Revenue and Taxation Code, are, I'll state the obvious, but it's worth saying in my view, horribly antiquated, out of date, and essentially useless, in my opinion as a lawyer, in figuring out how to assess software, whether it's the so-called BIOS, the basic operational system, or the non-BIOS software system. as a legal matter, having been assessor's counsel for a number of years, when you're representing your assessor in an appeal matter with a taxpayer who is selling or leasing equipment with highly sophisticated computer programming, it becomes a real headache to try and figure out what's going on and what is and is not assessable, let alone get to the value. It's been my experience that the assessee either wants a flat assumed number, X percent, 30, 40% of the value of the machine is the proposal to say that that is the value of the allegedly non-assessable I'll use the term software for purposes of this discussion. But often we get very little informational basis, and if we get any at all, we get it very late in the process. The constitutional duty of the assessor is to do the best possible assessment job and verify and get the number as correct as possible. It is very tough to do in this climate with these statutes, and it's my personal view, and everything I say here is my personal view. It does not reflect the CAA or any particular assessor or the county I currently work for. Rule 152 further complicates the process. It does not clarify and aid the process. The embedded software legal struggles that we have are over quality of pricing and value data and the quantity of data that we get. And if you don't have enough data and if it's not good data, assessors have a hell of a tough time coming up with a value that they can defend. What I will lastly talk about is what I'm going to label, where do we go from here? And this is where I especially stress these are my personal views. They do not reflect anybody I work for or have ever worked for in my career. So if you don't like what I say, talk to me. I believe, having worked with this board on various things since 1998, the State Board can play a very important role, not only in terms of its implementation of rules and regulations and interpretations, LTAs and the like, but they could also propose clarifying legislation that really cuts through this Gordian knot of this horribly antiquated legislation and comes up with a proposal. And I believe, not noting as well the old admonition, be careful what you ask for, you may get it, I would encourage the State Board through the consensus type of process that it employs in these processes to provide some real positive legislative fix, not just a tweak. A tweak is better than nothing. A tweak like AB 832 that I was privileged to be a part of in the process that helped put it together is a nice step so far as it goes, but it doesn't address the fundamental problems. We need to totally overhaul those old statutes. And in given the spirit of Article 13, Section 1 of the Constitution, and the fact that the programming industry in this state is no longer an infant industry that needs specialized tax policy protection, it is a full-blown middle-aged adult that can very well deal with its issues. I believe if I were king, and I know I'm not, but if I were king, I would urge the legislature to make all programming taxable, and let's let the assessors get down to the value of what is the value of the property, which is what the Constitution requires. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Tom. Our next speaker is Joe Venetieri. Joe is an attorney at law. Joe is a former mayor and currently serves as a member of the Whittier City Council. He practices primarily in matters of California state and local taxation, including sales and use tax, franchise income tax, and property tax. Joe is former deputy to Ernest Dronenberg, retired board member. And Ernie's out here now as one of the assessors, and is currently a member of the Institute of Professionals in Taxation. Joe.
Thank you, Senator Renner. And I was warned to keep my remarks, so I didn't do what I normally do. I wrote them down this time, so I'm gonna go through it that way.
But did you time them?
I did.
Okay,
time
good.
Them. I did time them.
Go
and
for
I've just
it.
Lost 30 seconds. Okay.
But you're not gonna get back.
I was warned. Several of us have been around the State Board of Equalization software wars for quite some time, whether it be within the context of sales tax, and such as the old Intel decision, which morphed into the TTA legislation, we recall, or the property tax and the valuation of computer equipment, the Hahn case, the Master Airlines Settlement Agreement, and now Cardinal Health. So it's clear that California, which is home of some of the greatest software minds in the world, continues to wrestle with taxation of software. And I want to share a little bit of my personal experience. Peter's talking about the state level. I want to talk about the locally assessed properties. Our firm represents various aerospace, high-tech defense contractors, research labs, as well as other like-kind companies. With the published Cardinal Court of Appeal decision, I was asked, well, how can I benefit from this case? How do we prove up the value of this application software? Well, I asked the same question of various assessor personnel in a couple different counties, and was responded to by somewhat of a puzzled, quizzical look, and then, well, show us what you got, and we'll let you know, which is always, that's assessor speak for, well, we're not quite sure. So in talking with our counsel, other counsel, and over a period of time, it became clear to me that from county to county, there was real no consensus as to what type of data, what kind of information could be provided that would be successful in proving up the value of the application software in that bundled product. So this uncertainty, what it does, it makes it difficult and frustrating for taxpayers to learn how to prepare and to prove up that value, obviously. And by no means is this frustration only on the part of taxpayers, as I've heard it from assessor personnel also. In an attempt to objectify the software valuation issue, and using the aerospace industry as an example, we found that there are generally two types of situations where non-assessable software is found. The first, for example, is where a company performs a multi-million dollar R&D project that's a self-constructed asset. And most of these projects have a tremendous amount of software development, researching, debugging. In fact, point of fact, sometimes that application software can constitute 50 to 60% or even more of that self-constructed asset. Because engineering labor and similar costs are captured for asset tracking purposes, that software engineering cost is usually ascertainable. But the more difficult situation, as has been alluded to, is where a company procures test and measurement equipment, such as a spectrum analyzer or an oscilloscope. The contractor procures that equipment generally at a lump sum price with no split out of cost for the tangible elements versus the application software elements. And what vendor would typically provide that information, as it would enable competitors to determine manufacturing costs and profit margins, proprietary information which is known only to that manufacturer. So as a practical matter, it is rare to receive an invoice that has this information separately stated. When we lean very heavily on that vendor for quantity discounts, and then we ask them for information on the breakout of the software, well, we find that to be pretty difficult. So, however, we have been able to procure some data, information in the context of add-on application software that was purchased separate and apart from the actual device. This information, I believe, can be very helpful, as it tends to give some type of idea as to the cost of that application software, which may then be attributed to that bundled price. Because of the frustration and lack of clarity, I want to suggest that an appropriate way to handle this situation would be for the State Board of Equalization to invoke its rulemaking authority to amend Rule 152. Now, I know others have proposed, and I would reiterate, that for purposes of statewide uniformity and equalization, the board categorized machinery equipment, M&E, into 8 or 10 categories, such as the medical equipment in Cardinal, or telecom equipment, as Peter is talking about, high-tech test and measurement equipment, whatever those categories might be. And in each category, it would be rebuttably presumed that a certain percentage of the cost of that equipment would be attributable to application software and therefore not subject to taxation. The board could convene an interested parties process and ask taxpayers from the various industries, as well as the vendors who supply equipment to those industries who have an interest in helping out, to provide studies, data, information to assist the board in conjunction with the California Assessors Association and industry groups to find reasonable and appropriate application software percentages for equipment in those categories. Now, this isn't a new process for the board in its leadership, as it's been done before in the promulgation of the computer tables, biotech, age 581, we're all familiar with all of them. But with the setting of the presumption for the various categories of equipment, this would act as a baseline for both assessors and taxpayers. And if a taxpayer thought the application software percentage was too low, it'd be incumbent upon the taxpayer to provide independent evidence to show that the number was too low. And likewise, the assessor would have the same opportunity if the assessor believed it was too high. Now, I understand some might say it's impossible or just too difficult to come up with the data to determine these percentages. And by no means is this solution perfect, but at least the idea of a rebuttable presumption can bring some clarity and uniformity to this difficult and very time-consuming process for all of us. And I think we're all in agreement, whether you be the state or you're the assessor or you're a taxpayer, that ease of administration and predictability, and I heard that earlier today, predictability is a goal that we should all seek to attain. Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you, Joe. Our last speaker on this topic is Larry Stone, Santa Clara County Assessor. As County Assessor, Larry has overseen the improvements to streamline the operations of his office, eliminating backlogs and achieving higher levels of public service. Larry has been a financial manager on Wall Street and was founder of two successful Bay Area real estate investment and development firms. He also served 16 years as a council member and mayor of Sunnyvale. Larry.
Thank you. I too want to thank the board for this opportunity. You know, embedded software is certainly a significant issue, probably the most significant issue that I have faced in the 16 and a half years I've been the assessor. If you take it to its extreme, it's estimated there may be $1 billion of property tax revenue at risk with this issue, and certainly in Santa Clara County, it's a big issue to us. We are the sixth largest county in population in the state. We have the fourth largest assessment roll, but we're number two in business personal property value. The legislature exempted application software in 1972, supposedly, I guess, to kick off or kickstart a new industry. It was easy back then. Basic operational software that was necessary to operate equipment was accessible, and application software, it's time you purchase at Fry's and download into your computer, was not accessible. Well, it's a different world today. Operational and application software is bundled, embedded, if you will, into sophisticated high-tech equipment. The rule generally is understood to be if you cannot operate the equipment or you would not operate the equipment without the software, then it's accessible. As in any property, real or business personal property, the assessors need evidence, documentation supporting the taxpayer's opinion of value and the exemption. It's kind of a trust and verify standard. I love quoting Ronald Reagan. AB 832, sponsored by assessors, wanted, quote, a clear and convincing evidence standard. What is embedded? And that's the same standard that the assessors face when in Rule 21, where assessors are subject to clear and convincing standard for cable television systems, for example. The current standard, preponderance of evidence, is analogous, in my opinion, to a drive-by appraisal of a shopping center or an office building. We just can't do that. We need the rent rolls, we need vacancies, we need square footage to determine an accurate and correct value. Industry seems to want ambiguity. Assessors need certainty. The law doesn't allow assessors to accept undocumented word from the taxpayers or to apply arbitrary percentages to embedded software. And arbitrary percentages would not reduce the number of assessment appeals, as is claimed. Companies would still file all appeals and argue that their percentages weren't enough for their type of equipment. And if you had arbitrary percentages that for some equipment that doesn't have any application software, they would be getting a reduction. The burden of proof in this issue is clearly on the taxpayer. And as to what is operational software and what is application software that is embedded in the machinery, it's impossible for assessors to independently verify what is embedded and not. Assessors must rely on information and data and documentation that we receive from the taxpayer. They have the information, we don't. So who is best to provide this evidence? Well, certainly the manufacturer of the software that sold it to the taxpayer is the only real reliable source. But manufacturers and suppliers are frequently refused to provide information when it may be detrimental to their customers. The bigger problem, I think, is when the taxpayer is also the manufacturer of that software. So it's often a catch-me-if-you-can type environment. Let me give you a couple of examples, real-life examples in Santa Clara County to this cat-and-mouse situation. An appeal from a major multi-billion dollar corporation, one of the largest in their industry. For years, the tax manager told us and testified before the Assessment Appeals Board under oath that the records we requested to verify the value of the equipment simply did not exist. That tax manager retires, we get a new tax manager, and they voluntarily provide the records that we asked for and then told us they always existed. In another major appeal, we had proof that the data provided by the taxpayer's consultant was fabricated. In Santa Clara County, companies that sell leading-edge information and storage and retrieval equipment tell us often that they can't provide the information and the data for their company, and that's the same stuff that they sell to other customers. Let me close by giving one quote from my testimony to the legislative committee that was considering AB 832. In today's world, almost everything is run by a computer chip. From wristwatches to cell phones to iPads to ATM machines to CAT scanners to automobiles, scanners at the checkout counter in supermarkets, and most, if not all, heavy equipment in manufacturing plants. Everywhere you look, machinery and equipment contains embedded chips basic to their function. To not require industry to provide the evidence to support their claims for the exemption would not only be unconstitutional, but it would relegate much of the value of modern equipment to scrap value. The issue is not whether there is software embedded in machines. It's whether the taxpayer can prove that what components are not essential to the basic operation and therefore not accessible, and what is.
Thank you, Larry. We're going to have a discussion up here now for members, for both members and also panelists to engage each other in some of the comments that were made. Member Steele has a comment.
You know, it's getting totally different today, and it's very hard to figure out which is non-taxable application software, and it is. But, you know, according to Mr. Parker, let's tax everything. That's not really right, because some of them are non-taxable application software involved with this equipment. So actually, I was studying this issue, and I was thinking about same as, you know, agreeing with Mr. Vanitari that regarding categorize the equipment first, and then if we're going to make it assessors easy, because sometimes that I see some of the assessors just taxing everything on the software on this equipment, instead of that through interest parties, then certain percentage of that software, non-taxable application software, like 10% of certain equipments are non-taxable. Then after, I really don't like tables, but we're gonna make tables. So make it assessors easy to assess these taxes, unless these business owners that they can provide that what is non-taxable, that they can really prove it. I think that's gonna be easy to start. Then, you know, we're gonna hear from other industries and how we're gonna work these through together, because taxing everything is not right. But at the same time, try to ask assessors to figure it out that, you know, what is taxable and what is not taxable. That's gonna be very, very complicated. And I think in the future, it's gonna be more complicated than ever. Thank you.
Other comments, questions? Comments from the panelists to each other, or clarify?
Yes. And Larry, I appreciate your comments, but I think it's important. Not all taxpayers shade the facts, and obviously there are, you know, one bad apple. What's the that goes with that? So I mean, yes, there are people out there who play games. There's no question about that. But that's not who we're talking about here. And it's very clear. I think it's rule. I don't have my rule book here, but I think it's Board Rule 325 or 315. That in local property tax equalization proceedings, the taxpayer has the burden of proof, unless it's a single family residence, unless it's an escape assessment. I don't need to go through that. So we do have the responsibility to bring forth that information. And I think we all agree with that. The only issue is, what is that information? How much of that information do we have to do? And for the reasons I articulated, it's very difficult to get a software manufacturer who is also doing the hardware, and it's bundled, to tell us what it is. It does happen on occasion. I had it happen one time in an airline context when we did the master settlement agreement. but that's the only time I've ever had it. So the issue then becomes, if it's a problem for us as the taxpaying side of it, if it's a problem for you on the assessor side, then there has to be a reasonable way based upon data, and I'm not talking about just arbitrary percentages, and I know you talked about that, but we're not talking arbitrary. We've got to have data, and we've done this process before, and sometimes it's very, I remember we were going through this on the computer tables. Remember how difficult it was to get that information? But we got some, didn't we? So I think that there's a very good chance, because from the standpoint of marketing for the people who make oscilloscopes and spectrum analyzers and the whole range of equipment we're talking about, they have an incentive to help out their customers. And I think it's a matter of, well, let's work with them. Let's see what they can do. Let's let the market kind of work on it, and let's work collaboratively. I heard that, I think, in the first panel. And I think if we give it a shot, and if it turns out there's no data, then, you know, that's our burden of proof, that's our problem. But I think the information is out there, and I think it's a matter of getting together and trying to make it work and analyzing that data.
Okay. Thank you, Joe. I'm going to ask those who want to make a comment from the public, if you could start queuing up here, that would be great. We're going to go to that. I think Larry wants to make a comment.
I'm not suggesting at all that all taxpayers or even the majority of taxpayers are trying to fool us or not providing accurate information or trustworthy information. I am suggesting that that's precisely the reason why assessors need proof, verification, and they need, that's why we trust and verify, because we never know who it is that might be, in the minority, of course, that might be providing inaccurate or fabricated information. I'm completely fine with percentages as long as they are based on accurate data that can be verified in the marketplace. If this is not difficult, then why hasn't it been done? It seems to me that you know, we put the burden of proof on the taxpayer. They tell us in many cases they can't do it. But let me just give you three cases real quickly. Three real cases in Santa Clara County. Case number one, the Assessment Appeals Board found, and these are all with major corporations, the Assessment Appeals Board found no credible evidence that would prove that there was non-assessable software in that machine. They denied it. The Assessment Appeals Board in case number two found credible evidence because the company provided us with that data, and they granted the exemption. Case number three, the company provided the assessor with credible, detailed cost information sufficient to verify, and we allowed the exemption. So all of those three things happened. And all I'm saying is, if you provide us with the data, as in case number two or number three, we will grant the exemption. But we can't do it by just saying 10% on this equipment and 23% on that without the relative data that can be verifiable.
Okay, Mr. Bernard.
Real quick, I still, again, same as the previous conversation, what's the real question here? And in my opinion, the real question is, does the 1972 law make sense? What we're talking about, coming up with tables and exempting this, that is, in my opinion, bandaging up something that doesn't make sense today. Embedded software is everywhere. Your cell phone doesn't have it in it. It's actually going to be toxic waste. Your cell phone will be toxic waste. My wheelchair, no embedded software, it's junk. It's not worth anything. We have a job to assess property at its full, at its market value. That's part, if it's an integral part of the machine, it just makes sense that it is accessible. I think we need to look back at the 1972 law. This is coming from someone who, and many of you know me in my previous life, a pretty conservative anti-tax person. And you know, when Larry Stone and I agree on something, all right, it's scary, but it means it's probably correct. I think we need to really look at the 1972 law and make some sense of it, because what was applicable in 72 sure is not applicable today. The last case in point, we were all supposed to come in a bus this morning. The lift broke down, and I will guarantee you that it was because of the software that's in that lift that was a problem. So, and I noticed that these steps aren't working again, and it's probably the software that's embedded in the mechanism. But the point is, you can't get away from it. It's in everything. It's in that camera that's taking the pictures. The value of the machinery is without the software is nil or salvageable.
Okay.
The other choice you could have, go to the legislature and let's just exempt personal property. How do you like that?
I'd
go with that too. But either clarify the 72 law, get rid of personal property, trying to bandage it up, in my opinion, is just making a bad law.
Okay. Member Hughes.
Thank you, Senator Renner. Let me just start out with a statement first. I agree with Assessor Stone that we require certainty. I would argue that certainty really resides with both the assessor and the taxpayer. So with that goal in mind, I would agree with Mr. Bordenaro in terms of the 72 statute. That has to be addressed, just straight up. Obviously, it's inapplicable, not necessarily relevant today. I also think that the likelihood of getting a proposal like AB 832 enacted is difficult. But I want to go back to a couple of suggestions that several of the speakers have spoken to, and that is the role of the board in this particular matter. And I would be interested to know from the speakers whether there is a role for the board to look at being the party that gets the data, obtains the data, and begins to put together some percentages that aren't arbitrary. And I know it means looking at lots of different types of equipment, but it at least would engage the parties on both sides. We would look for the most credible data that is out there. And we've done this in other areas with respect to, you know, valuation, lifing studies. And what is wrong with that process?
Go ahead and have somebody go ahead and respond.
I personally don't see anything wrong with it. I believe that's absolutely in the purview and responsibility of your board. I view that as something of a big picture policy bandage, but it does have its usefulness.
And it's not to say that takes the place of the statute. I think we still need to tackle the statute head on. But at least for practical, you know, assessment practice purposes or evaluation.
Go ahead, Joe.
The reality is the law is cardinal, and the law says that application software is not subject to tax. The only issue until it gets overturned, whether it's a good policy decision or not to do away with 995, the only issue is how do we value that application software? Mm-hmm. You have a very expert property tax department that has been doing this for at least 20 to 25 years now. And this is particularly well suited for that expertise. And I would strongly encourage the board to take the leadership and to do it.
Yeah, and I'm just saying we have to tackle the statute because there's a huge gap between 1972 and Cardinal. So that's. Yeah.
I'm gonna ask us now to go ahead and let the public come on up and make their comment, if you will. Same as before. Name who you represent and a brief comment.
Dave Doerr, representing Caltax. Feel I must come talk about this because I did the staff work on the 1972 bill, was carried by my boss, Joe Gonzalez, and I think there's some misunderstandings here. I do agree that there's a significant problem in terms of the identification segregation, and the board has an important role. That's one of the reasons the board exists, for uniformity property tax procedures, so we agree with that. But the 72 bill at the time was trying to deal with the separation out of intangible values. We weren't, in the Constitution doesn't provide for assessing intangibles. We're trying to separate intangible values, and that's the reason, the whole thrust of the 1972 bill. And that, in context, when you, it came after the problem of assessing movie films, where that you had a film that was had a certain value, but most of that was felt to be intangible. The film itself didn't have the value, it was intangible values. And then we went on to other kinds of records, such as business records, that were thought to be intangible. The paper, it's on a piece of paper, that's tangible. But the feeling that the work on that, putting it there, represented the intangible values. Same with architect's drawings and things like that. So the issue wasn't trying to benefit some industry or this or that. It was dealing with intangible problems. And the other issue, we're talking about constitutional problems. One, it's intangible. Two, personal property does not have the same constitutional protection as real property. The legislature can change it or do away with it. So it's not a constitutional issue.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Come on up. And other speakers? One other one? Come on up, please.
Jason Chow with Ernst & Young. There are methodologies that have been used to quantify software. These have been done for financial reporting purposes, for tax purposes, for accounting purposes. You know, here there's techniques that have been used to quantify, you know, whether it's an intangible or a software, you know, component. And I think here, you know, when these methods then were developed, it was sort of like what, you know, you were saying before, is that it's not easy. You know, the data is not readily available, but it was done. And, you know, these methodologies have been accepted by, you know, the tax authorities, you know, whether it's income tax or federal tax, or even from the accounting regulatory bodies. So there is a way, you know, that to measure it, it's been done in other venues. So perhaps here, you know, there could be a way to develop a process.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
I believe you're correct. I think that companies do not just pull the cost of this stuff out of the air. Many have cost accountants that do nothing but monitor and control the cost that go into manufacturing any one of their products, labor costs, material costs, overhead, and all that kind of stuff. The companies that do are the ones that get the exemption for either from the Assessment Appeals Board or from my staff. Those that don't, don't.
Okay, I'm going to bring us to conclusion and thank the panelists at this point. Also want to thank the Assessors Association for participating and responding to our summons. Is that what we did to them? and appreciate that greatly. I want to especially thank to our folks that were key to helping us put this together, David Gao and Dean Kinney, and helping us to lead this process. At this point, I think what we want to do is I'm going to turn this back over to the chair, because I think one of the issues that came up in this discussion is, what is our role? Where do we want to go from there? And I think we want to have a brief discussion in regards to maybe what we have gleaned from this and where we need to respond to and opportunities that we have before us based upon the discussion that we had. So, Mr. Chair. Okay.
Thank you very much, Mr. Renner, for your leadership in conducting the hearing. It's very informative, very stimulating in thought as well. Obviously, there are some very complex issues, but not really all that complex when you look at the reality that the world has changed. And the world has changed significantly from a scientific perspective, from an academic perspective, and the things that we've done over the last 50 years just won't suffice in the next 50 years as we move forward in trying to address these issues from a governing perspective, from a taxation and evaluating whether it's fairness in taxation, establishing values, defining what is and what's not. So we have some real challenges here, but these are challenges that we can meet. I mean, we have the intellectual capacity to do this, working with the assessors and the Board of Equalization. We have the intellectual capacity to meet these challenges, and I certainly welcome an opportunity to do that. We're going to ask for closing remarks from Member Yi and the rest of our members. Did I catch you off, Mark? Okay. In such cases, we'll go to the assessors. I'm okay catching you off guard. Are you ready?
Yeah.
Okay. Member Yi, my apologies.
Thank you. Sorry. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I wanted to offer some thoughts on both issues, and thank you, Senator Renner, for moderating two very stimulating panels. With respect to the first panel on split role, I really hope we're not back here in 2 years, kind of we're in the same place. And I would like to advance the examination of the issue in this regard. I really don't think, and today may be the beginning of, I hope, an ongoing public discourse about the issue, but I really don't think it serves any party, any purpose, if it's not an informed public discourse. And I really want to figure out how to get our arms around the conflict that exists among the data and among the studies that have been put forth on split role. I think the public discourse really ought to be, or the informed public discourse should start with not even an identification of a problem, because that automatically becomes a political discussion, but really, what's the lay of the land? What's happened since 1978? And as we have competing studies that suggest that certain types of property have been treated more advantageously than others. I would like to have some neutral third party, and I really am looking at our own research and statistics division, to essentially do kind of a fact check with all of the data that's out there and all the studies that are out there. It's a tall order, and it does become easily politicized, but I really do not want it to be politicized. We as a board, and we in partnership with the county assessors, we have a responsibility in administering this property tax system. And outside parties have some desire to move with any kind of type of a split roll proposal, I want to be able to speak with at least some level of credibility about what those proposals may mean. And so I think the next step is really trying to resolve some of the conflicts that are out there among the studies and the data in some formalized way. Maybe I'll leave it to that, and I'll speak on the second issue when it's time.
Thank you, Member Yee. Ms. Mandel? Mr. Baldinario.
All I'm going to say is thank you for the opportunity. And I also want to thank Doug for leaving me these issues to deal with next year. Appreciate that a lot.
You're welcome.
And for the association for putting me in the position where we need to deal with these issues in this next year. It's going to be challenging, but again, I think if we could all get out and sit down at the table, be realistic, and get what the facts are, whether it is in the embedded software issue or the split roll, and be reasonable, then I think that we can together find solutions to these and other problems. Thank you.
Doug.
I'd like to also echo some of Tom's remarks in that. First of all, I want to thank the board and members of the panels for the discussions we've had today. We have some issues we need to get resolved, and I think the only way we're going to get them resolved is through what we're starting and what we've done today. And hopefully this coming year we'll make some progress. So again, I just want to thank everybody that did participate, as well as our people out in the audience. I think it's important that we address these issues, move forward. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Mr. Runner.
Just a couple comments on, and I'll to make it on both the topics. The first would be, I would agree with Member Yee in terms of, I think a good rule for us to have would be to step back, have our folks take a look at reviewing, doing some look at the various studies, the issues, the assumptions that have been made in regards to some of the conflicts and issues in regards to split role. I think that would be good data for us to have. And I think that we've got the ability and capacity to at least blend that and bring that together. I think that's a good issue. I also believe that probably in regards to the embedded software, it could be time for us to take a look at how it is that we can bring together interested parties to determine if there's a path to find solution. I think we've talked about some of the options here. I'm trying to get my arms around the concept of percentages on industries that go from, A to Z. But I guess we ought to find out if there's a path there. And certainly I think that's a way to help solve the problem that seems to be right now not solvable, and that may be a path to help get us there. So I think we ought to take a look at maybe looking at bringing this back, maybe as a future discussion for us in regards to how it is that we may want to look at looking at the process of percentages, some aspect of that.
Okay. Member Yee.
Thank you. I agree with Senator Runner. I was going to even take it a step further to see if the Property Tax Committee staff could convene just a discussion.
Something. We certainly would be. We could initiate that.
Yeah, I mean, I really do think that rather than have this continue to be fought, through the legislature, where we're kind of looking at perhaps the assessors and the industry having to take some very hard positions. I think there's a role for this board to play to bring people together.
The legislative path is fraught with so many challenges.
Yeah. And I was particularly intrigued by the gentleman that came up from Ernst & Young with respect to how some of this information and data is available for financial accounting purposes. So to the extent that it's available for that purpose, how does that translate for tax assessment purposes?
Members, let me suggest that it be a joint effort of the Business Tax Committee as well as Property Tax, along the lines of trying to come up with a methodology and a technique as it relates to assessing the embedded software. I don't know if there are standards or if there is a way of coming up with a table that's going to be applicable to everyone, but I certainly believe that there is a methodology, that we can come up with a method, we can come up with a technique which can be employed in every situation, given that the data is there. Even if the default is to say that there is no exemption until the data is provided, that's certainly a reasonable approach as well. And so I think we can entertain that from the board's perspective. So let us take that under consideration. And in closing, let me thank all of you individually and collectively for sharing with us a moment in time. We won't get this moment in time back again, but certainly we'll have an opportunity to revisit the issues. Thank you so very much, and enjoy the rest of your day. The board is hereby adjourned.
Oh.